Yep. And also your slide guitar, when did you start learning that and getting into the slide part of it?
Yeah, like I think I just heard, you know, Dust My Broom or something like that, you
Yep.
know. And the first time I played slide on a record was Morning Good Morning. I came up with that riff, you know. Morning, good
Good
morning,
morning.
love to see the sunshine. So
Yeah.
that was my first, and I used to just play on the D position where you your bar, and you can play in there. And then later on, I got to find out about different tunings and stuff. So yeah, that was my first into slide. I just like the sound of it. It's a really cool sound.
Yeah, gonna see my baby tonight. You were experimenting with some jazz type chords in that.
Yeah, I bought a Mel May book to try and broaden my knowledge and get away from what I had and try and broaden things. And I was in a van. Swampy was driving. We had a beautiful van, Ford Transit, double wheel Transit, and we had some aeroplane seats in the back. You know, in those days, the roadies had their pride and joy was their vans, and so I was noodling on the guitar, just behind him as he drove. And everyone was sitting there, and we were on our way back to Sydney, and I played the intro of those chords and was singing, I'm going to love you a lot, like right to the back of Swampy, you know, like having a big joke,
yeah.
And acting like a seductive kind of nightclub singer, you know.
Yeah.
And everyone was cracking up. And so after that, he goes, well, what happens then? And then from then on to Sydney, I came up with the chords and going to see my baby tonight.
Wow. And it was that on when the radio ban was on? Was that when that was out? Was it 71, was it?
Well, we recorded it after that at some stage down in Melbourne.
Yep.
And it got into the top 10. So
yep.
That was the closest I got to, you know, commercial success and on the hit parade.
Yeah.
We followed that up with more that Morning Good Morning one I just mentioned, and that didn't do quite so well, although it's a song, people love it.
Yeah.
This one, just by the way it goes in commerciality, sometimes it sticks, sometimes it doesn't, but it's one of those songs that people ask me to play quite a lot, and because it sticks in your head.
It's probably a song, sorry mate, it's probably a song that I think that you could actually blow a bit of harp over, and it sounds really good.
Yeah, it's just got that, like a riff, and there's another riff that's a good riff that, well, I played at a sound check. When Joel Walsh was with me in the Party Boys,
yep.
He said, who wrote that? And I said, oh, I did. And he said, I like that, I love that. And that's a riff that a harp would be great with.
Yeah.
He said, it was like, yep. A bit higher, of course. Yeah, it's just a long, different, you know, because he thought it was from somewhere, because it's, when you come up with something, it sounds really legitimate, you know, or fresh or original. It's quite a thing because, you know, you've got 12 notes and everything is just about being done inside out and upside down, sideways and back at the front. Well, that's what you've got to do to try and come up with something original.
Now, also, like, you've got a number of guitars that you use, and I know from talking to Doc Spann, we interviewed Doc a while back, and I saw him play with Nick Charles just close by here to the studio, and I got to talk to Doc a bit then, and I find it very hard to play, being an amateur harmonica player, over the top of some of your tracks, because I've got sort of the basic tunings, your G and your A and your D, and you see,
yeah,
I do have
yeah.
a B flat, but and I love the B flat harmonica, but he told me that you have some interesting tunings or different tunings that...
Yeah, well, I basically, overall, with my normal standard tuning structure of guitar, I tune down a semitone like a lot of blues guys do, because I've got a low voice.
Yep.
And I just find that that's a bit more comfortable for me. You know, when I was younger, I was in concert pitch. But now, of course, you know, it's harder to get those keys of... and not many guys carry them, but, you know, Doc's got them all.
Yep.
And because he's going to say, you've got to get the sharps and flat keys to sort of, you know, play. If I'm playing A, it's actually, you know, A flat or G sharp.
Yeah.
And
cross out.
You know, you've got to have those ones, and then it's pretty much the same, you know.
Yeah. In I think it was 2005, you were diagnosed with nose and throat cancer.
Yeah. It was basic nasal pharyngeal carcinoma, which is a nasal thing. So
I'm glad you said that because I didn't think I'd get that.
Yeah, all the big words.
Yep. How did this impact you and your family at the time? And looking back, has it changed you as a person or as a musician?
Yeah, definitely. It'd have to have an effect because, you know, that sort of thing takes you to places you've never been before emotionally and, you know, health-wise and spiritually, the whole thing, because it's a brush with death, you know.
Mm.
And yeah, which is really weird because we'd moved up out of Sydney and we living on this beautiful valley, got 80 acres and looking over a valley and in the dead-end road and sort of clean air and all that sort of stuff. And all of a sudden I get diagnosed with that. It was kind of like, what? You know, I got really angry about it.
Yeah.
And really, well, you don't know how you get this stuff. There's so many different types of cancer. Everyone reacts differently. There's all the different treatments and drugs they give you. But, you know, it was just a horrible thing to have to go through. But I've got a wonderful wife and she stuck by me and we did a lot of alternate stuff. Like we were having, you know, 7 juices a day. Raw. I've got it on my website. There's actually what we did. And a lot of people, because you get confronted with, well, what are we going to do? You know, we've got the straight medicine people, but is there anything else we can do? So we did a Riff Salento diet, which was primarily organic juices, and to lift our immune system up, you know.
Yeah.
And to help fight from there too. But hey, I wanted to live, so we also went went and got the radiation, and at the very end they said, well, because he gave me 8 months to live because it would spread into my brain, and it wouldn't be good. So we did everything, and then they added the cocktail of chemo at the end. Because I said it would give you another 20% and all this, so we went and did it. But, boy, that was horrible stuff. So, you know, I was really feeling sorry for myself. But when you're in hospital and you see a lot of other people, you know, I saw one fellow that obviously was involved in a fire or an explosion or something, and half his legs were blown off and arms and just half his face was going. And I'm thinking, well, stop feeling sorry for yourself, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just one of those things that when you get taken down, the chemo I felt was like the will destroy it, because I liken it to my father pruning trees right back when they had a thing called canker, which was like a cancer, and he would have to cut them right back. So that's what they do with the chemo. They take you right down before if they give you any more, it'll kill you.
Yeah.
And it's not specifically targeting cancer cells, it's wiping everything out.
Yeah.
I hope they will one day have a way of just targeting the cells, because I went for my last chemo and they said, oh, we can't give you any more to kill you, so go away and grow back, just like what dads with the trees, you know.
Yeah.
So I came through it, and basically knocking on death's door there, but thinking that was just going to be all over, because the will, it's a will killer, that chemo.
Yeah.
Because it's so weak and you can't eat, and it's just horrible. So just you grow back and you go, well, you've been there, done that. It's like, wow, it's good to be alive. Yeah. You know, where the grass is greener, everything sort of,
yeah.
For quite a few months afterwards, you feel like as you get stronger, you know, it all becomes brighter and more lively. And then, you know, a couple of years down the track, it's like you're back to normal. But I've got a few side effects. Like, I mean, the chemo, the radiation killed my saliva glands. So I've had to, I'm currently having teeth work done, because the saliva keeps your pH level of your mouth on a level. And without that, your teeth go bad. So that's just one thing I'm contending with, but hey, I can still play.
You can, you got a story there too. Another side effect when you were on Rockwiz.
Yeah, because the chemo, he said it's gonna, your treatment's gonna lose your hair, lose your salivary glands, lose your teeth, and lose some feeling in your fingers, and lose some hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And And I said, this sounds like it's designed for guitar players and musicians. And I said, I'm not doing that. And then suddenly he said, well, you've got 8 months, you know. He said, okay, do it. Do it to me. The hearing thing, it happened because we've got altitude where we live and your ears pop when you're going down on to go to Brisbane and stuff. And you're always clear. But when I was going through treatment, I noticed that I was always losing top end. And I was on Rockwiz, and they played really quiet, and it said, well, very quiet. And then I asked the guy to turn up Julia, but she was asking me a question. And, of course, I didn't hear it right. And it was one of those ones whereby you have to sing a line of a song. She gives you a part, and then you... And I just screwed it right up. And they had to stop the thing because I didn't hear it properly. I didn't hear it properly. So, yeah, and the next day my wife goes, off you go. You got to go and get some hearing aids. So that was me. And I told the guy when I was getting my hearing aids, I said, look, there's the ultimate ad for your hearing aids on Rock was coming up. And they edited it out to save my embarrassment, I suppose.
That's right. They give you a word. They give you a word or something, don't they? And then you sing a song that has that word in it.
Yeah. She was saying crying, and I thought she said time. So I hadn't got one question white the whole night. I'm feeling like a real dumb prick, you know, sitting there.
It'd be pretty daunting.
And I heard it, thought I heard it go time. So I sprout up, you know, confident as anything. Time is on my side. Yes, it is. And I'm really, really, yeah, this is great, you know. And
she's looking at you.
She's looking at me, you know, sort of asking for something else. And as I'm watching her, my sort of tone and confidence dies into a, oh dear, wrong thing. So, yeah, it was hilarious, really.
Yeah.
But they did save me the embarrassment. But here I am embarrassing myself. That's pretty good.
Yeah, it was good television.
Oh, right. It was good radio. It's a good radio. Hey, folks.
I'm gonna love you all night long. But when the streetlights die, I'll be gone.